I sang that song for more than 60 years, a song of praise to Joseph Smith, the prophet of the Restoration and founder of the LDS Church, the church I served as a bishop for 5 years. I knew the church was true. I was a faithful Latter-day Saint.
My life has been built on certain truths, but wishing doesn't change the truth.
Jesus said, "You shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free." When I finally learned the truth about the real history and doctrines of Mormonism, I realized that I was following the gospel of Joseph Smith and not the gospel of Jesus Christ. I have come to learn that many others have made a similar journey out of the bondage of religion and into an authentic relationship with Jesus. And that's what this show is all about. Courageous people who want to share their story, hoping that you, the viewer, will discover the same new life in Jesus. So if you're a Latter-day Saint who is struggling with questions or seeking a genuine encounter with the Savior, we invite you to join us tonight. We have a joyful message that we want to share with you. Good evening and welcome to the Ex-Mormon Files here in the heart of Salt Lake City. I'm your host, Bishop Earl. And I'm really pleased tonight to be able to welcome Carl Moore, husband of Atalie Moore from last week.
Yeah.
Nice to have you with us, Carl.
Thank you.
We have a few things to kind of cover from what Atalie shared with us, but we'll do that in a minute, I suppose. Okay. As we do, usually, why don't you begin telling us a little bit about your time as a Latter-day Saint? You were born in the church.
Yeah, I was born in the church, and I'm not sure exactly what, I don't want to overlap what Atalie said, I guess.
Well, this would be your personal beginning.
My personal beginning was Lamanite to begin with.
Yeah.
My parents, strong in the church. I don't remember ever missing a day of church.
Really?
Always had a testimony from the very beginning. That's the way that it works, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, your parents believe something, you believe something.
Baptized at 8?
Yeah, actually, when I was baptized at 8, and there's kind of an interesting story there, I was so excited to be baptized when my dad told me that he wasn't worthy to baptize me, he gave me the option: you can either wait for me to be worthy, or someone else can baptize you. And I was so excited to be baptized. Yes. I had my two uncles, my one uncle baptized me, and my other uncle confirmed me a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And so,
wow,
that was my fervent, my excitement to be baptized at that time.
Where did you grow up?
I grew up in Orem.
In Orem.
Yep,
and
Utah County.
Were you born there in Orem?
I was born in Phoenix, Arizona, but we moved to Orem when I was five. My parents went to BYU.
They did?
Yes.
And they were very active and married in the temple and all
they
that?
They weren't married in the temple, but they were sealed
in
the temple when
did
I was...
Did you go in and were you sealed
Yeah,
with
I think
them?
I think I was about two or three, though. I don't remember. No. I don't remember that.
Now, you mentioned you're a Lamanite.
Oh, yeah.
Which we'll cover a little bit more, too. Was there certain pride with that, was there?
Well, absolutely. Absolute pride. I loved it. I was the true blood of Israel.
Yeah.
I had special rights to knowing that the Book of Mormon was true. I felt like I was above other people because, like I said, I had the true blood of Israel. I wasn't adopted like other people. I felt like I had a special connection with the Book of Mormon because that was written
to
the Lamanites.
Yeah, it says that in the title page,
absolutely.
Doesn't it? Yeah.
It's changed, but it'll continue to change as DNA proofs come out. But it was a sense of pride. And then back then you had Lamanite generation. Now it's
that's right. This
now it's Living Legends because there's no such thing as Lamanite, so they changed the name to be politically correct. But anyways, yeah. So I was absolutely a devout member. I mean, I was always a sinner, but
you didn't know that then, though, of course, probably,
well,
or did
I
you?
I knew I was a sinner.
Oh, did you? Okay.
But, you know, the thing about growing up in Utah County is when all your friends are LDS and you're all doing things that are wrong, it's okay.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Well,
I don't
I
know if you
know.
Do.
You rationalize.
Yeah,
a lot.
It wasn't, you weren't looked down upon as much. And,
oh, okay.
But anyways.
Did you take seminary, though? And
oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Yep.
And
went to seminary.
Scouting, were you... Scouter?
I was a scout, yeah. Mm-hmm. I went through all the ranks. In fact, I opposed to become an Eagle Scout because everyone's telling me you have in order to get a good job or to be someone important, you have to be an Eagle Scout. And so I kind of was like, then I'm not going to do it because I'll prove myself otherwise. But that was just kind of my
a little rebellion
attitude.
There.
Yeah, I was rebellious to having to be an Eagle Scout to be somebody. Yeah. But
never any doubt that the church was true though, right? I mean, you just
never a doubt.
Yeah. Never
a doubt.
Your testimony. Or?
I bore my testimony all the time.
Did you?
As a youth and as an adult, I bore it like crazy. I got complimented a lot of times on my testimony. I think I helped build other people's testimonies, and that's yeah. what Fast and Testimony Meeting
yeah,
is.
Really,
it's a motivational time when you can get together and boost everyone up and feel
yeah.
good and cry together. And
yeah.
That's what that's about.
I went through a few of those myself over the years and every month. Did you ever have any questions about the church at all? Did anything ever come up during this time that said, thought, well, that's a little weird or something?
No. I remember the first weird thing that I learned about the church was masonry, but I quickly just went to... Well, they were the builders of Solomon's Temple,
yeah.
and that was truth then, and truth is being revealed now, and I didn't really understand masonry, just like you don't understand what works really are.
Yeah,
I didn't understand what masonry, and I looked at masonry as, oh, they're good people, they're doing good things for the world, and they're trying to better themselves.
Mm.
But that's exactly what they're doing, is they're bettering themselves, and they're not letting Jesus, they're not letting God do it, and they're taking the credit. It's humanism.
Yeah.
And I think that's what Mormonism is. It's a lot of humanism.
It's kind of taking our eyes off of Christ and putting it more on ourselves and what
yeah.
we can do.
Yeah, yeah, and ranks. And same thing with scouts. It's
wow.
these ranks.
Yeah.
Rank.
And all your
it,
own
it proves
accomplishments.
Something.
Yeah.
And priesthood, rank.
Now, Adley told us that you married young, you guys, so you didn't go on a mission.
I did not.
Yeah. But you guys had eventually went through the temple,
mm-hmm.
and how was that experience for you?
Well, let me just first start by the mission thing. I didn't go on a mission. I got married. I was 18. I was almost 19. But I was looking forward to the day when I could, me and Allie could go as a couple missionaries.
Oh.
I was,
looking to be
a senior
couple. Yeah,
senior couple, but since we started early, I figured we'll get our family done early and we'll get out there as soon as possible, and I was excited for that moment. When it comes to the temple, I was excited to go to the temple, went through the temple.
Was it what you thought it was?
No, I don't think it's ever for anyone who goes to the temple what you think. I don't think they can prepare you for that, just because it's so unlike what you would go through. When you go to church, it's a certain way. When you go
yeah.
through the temple, it's just different, and
totally
you wear
different
clothes and things. And I wasn't offended by anything, and I just
yeah.
thought that this is the way that it is. It's weird, but I remember my testimony of the temple actually came from structure. It didn't come from really feelings. It came from God is organized, because they're LDS is really big into just pushing that into you. Organization.
Yeah.
Look how cleanly this thing runs.
Yeah.
It's a well-oiled machine.
That's a good point.
But so that was my testimony of, and but up until the day that God opened my eyes, I went to the temple often. I mean, at least
did you?
I made a commitment to go at least once a month. And about 2 years before God opened my eyes, I was going at least twice a month. And in the occupation that I had, building LDS meeting houses, I got to travel all over, and I got to visit a lot of different temples.
Wow.
So, you know, like DC Temple.
You were doing work on them, you're saying?
No, I was building LDS meeting houses.
Oh, building the meeting houses.
Yeah.
I see, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
And
but,
so you attended temples in the areas that
you
go to.
A lot of different temples,
yeah.
And, you know, I was excited to do that. Our days off, I would go to the temple, other people would do other things, but I just borrowed a truck and went to the temple.
Did you ever, I used to do this, did you ever, when you got your name in the temple, we always go through for someone else after
mm-hmm.
the first time you go through, did you ever talk to that person spiritually or in your mind and either pray to that person or to say?
That's interesting. I never did.
I sat there and I'd pray to that person and say, you know, I don't know where you're at in the eternities here, but I'm doing this work for you. And I hope
Sorry. I thought you were talking about the new name that you received.
Oh, no. I'm talking about the name of the person or that person.
Okay. I felt Yeah, I always try to get spiritually connected, you know, and I really try to really sink, and I try to feel that spirit, and I really try to pay attention for that person. I was really diligent on, you know, because after you go through so many times, you know what's going to happen. But I remember purposefully thinking, I need to pay attention because I'm doing this for somebody else, you know, and that was the purpose. So,
well, I know this is going to be a quick bridge, and we'll get back to your story, but
okay.
Talk just a little bit about the veil in the temple and what that, how that's changed for you since we're mentioning
the temples. Veil in the temple. Well, that.
I mean, without saying anything,
I know
that would offend the Mormons.
But the thing about the veil is why would you put up a veil when God tore it down? Why would you do that?
See, I don't think most Mormons know that the veil was torn in half when Christ was crucified.
And God did it from the top to the bottom.
That's in Luke. Tells us that, I think.
I'm not sure, but he did it. That's the fact.
He tore
that veil apart, and he made access. Everyone had access to go into that Holy of Holies, because that's what the veil separated man from God. And now we, as priests, royal priesthood, you are a royal priesthood. That's what Paul says. You are a royal priesthood. Yeah. Now we have access to that. And Jesus Christ, being our great and final high priest, he's mediating
the
whole time.
He's the one that shed his blood. And now instead of the high priest from the Jewish high priest going in and sprinkling the blood, he shed his blood.
Oh, yeah. He's the high priest. He's the scapegoat. He is the sacrifice all in one. He's everything, still lives. Untransferable priesthood. They don't understand that either, but
no. Well, I just think that's such a wonderful part of what I learned about Christianity. Anyway, back to your story. So you're with Adelie, and you've gone through the temple. You're active in church.
And, an active Lamanite again. I think I think Lamanites or brown people get some kind of a status when they're in the LDS Church, or black people, for instance. It's like kind of like they're looked at more, I don't know how you'd say
like
it, but more
like
special.
A convert to the church or something.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, man, they're special. And you know, most of the time in this, I don't know, it's not stereotypical or prejudice type thing, but we're so emotional as people.
Yeah.
At Lamina, our Polynesians, Native American, we're emotional people. And when we bear testimony, we bear it with our heart, you know. And I was passionate for my wards, and I was super passionate for that gospel.
And knowing that you do Lamanite dances or traditional dances, you've done a lot of those, like for Eagle Scout Courts of Honor and different things, didn't you?
Oh yeah, still do. I still would love to do it.
Oh, you still do.
You know?
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I think we're going to put up a website and people can contact you if they're interested in having you do some of those. I've seen them several times, and they're amazing.
Yeah, and I would love to do that, but most of all, I would actually like to do it for churches. If there's people out there in churches, I'd love to come to your church for a youth group, an outreach, any kind of occasion, anything. I would love to do it. I'd love to glorify God. That's the whole purpose in why I do what I do. To glorify God, to spread the gospel of grace.
Yeah.
And just...
That's wonderful.
So, anyways.
Well, great. Well, so Adelie tells us a little bit of her story in the fact that her mom has questioned the church, and her older brother, I guess, has questioned the church. She tries to prove them wrong and goes to the Bible and finds out, maybe there's something here I've missed. And when does she tell you about this?
She never told me about it, really. I never knew that she had found out the church wasn't true. You know, I never knew that I guess it was for about a year. So that whole year, I remember we got in a lot of arguments.
She miserable?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, I bet she was.
She's dealing with a guy who's, just totally deceived.
Well, it's devastating. I mean, it really puts stress on your heart. And your mind to think that you've believed one thing, and I never shared anything with my wife either, with Carla. I couldn't share it, but I was miserable.
Oh, I can see how miserable she was just by going to. I've been to a few LDS meetings and some funerals. It's just heart wrenching. It's just so. I'm going to use the word gross. It burns. It kills. How bad it is, People don't realize how it is and how dead it is, and it just pains me to go to these meetings because it's dead. And I was pulling into her, and I was always excited to go to the temple, and she'd never go to the temple with me.
What did you think of her? I mean, did you think she'd lost her way? Satan had her? Was apathetic?
I knew that she was getting a relationship with Jesus.
Really?
And actually, to tell you the truth, I was jealous of that relationship. I could see that she was loving Jesus more and more and more, and I felt like, you need to love me, you need to love me. You know, why are you loving Jesus more? And I think that's another thing about Mormonism is you start loving your family more, you start loving your kids more, you start loving...
Idols almost.
Yes,
not right.
Well, that's exactly what they are, but you need to love Jesus first. If Jesus is not first, there's nothing after that.
Yeah.
And anyway, so she's my wife is loving Jesus, and I was offended by that, you know, and it made me angry.
Well, she said she dropped a few hints here and there.
She did, and I didn't realize that there were hints.
Okay.
I don't know what I thought, but basically, so she never told me. Wow. And so it wasn't until the day that God opened my eyes that, you know, and I'm upstairs crying in the room, and she asked me why I'm crying, and I tell her, well, it's because it's not true, and then she tells me, well, I know it's not, and then, I mean, that's the only time that I realized.
What brought you to this moment then? I mean, what happened?
Absolutely by the grace of God. That's all it was, by the grace of God, because I was not looking for a way out. I built myself up so high. Doctrinally, I knew a lot of things, but they didn't faze me. Polygamy, polyandry, masonry, blacks in the priesthood, I already knew that. But all these things, I already knew about these things, but I believe that was the meat. That was the stuff because I was a mature member in the church, and I was mature enough to understand these things.
Be able to attack.
And then you have these other people like converts, and you don't present these things to them because they can't handle it.
The milk.
You need to build them
the
up.
Milk.
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly. So I knew all this stuff, and I was totally confident in it all.
Yeah.
But like I said, by the grace of God, he tore me out. He tore that out of me. He tore that heresy. He tore that out of me, and I knew, just like black and white, that what I had believed was wrong my whole life.
Were you in
the
process of praying? I mean, what was the...
I wasn't praying. Like I said, I wasn't asking for it. I was...
Oh, my goodness.
All I was doing was reading, I think it was Wife 19, just... I think I just barely started. It had nothing to do with doctrine either.
Yeah.
It was just a story. And I have no idea what even it was, but it just came to me, you know.
This must have been the answer to Adelie's prayer, because she said, we've got to be on the same page here, and you've got this little wonderful family of seven kids, and you love each other, and she wants you to be on the same page, and God said, okay, let's take care of that, and so you went upstairs, and was she up there then?
No, I just went upstairs, and I'm bawling my face off. I'm crying.
What were you thinking?
What I was thinking was, I'm scared of my family. I'm scared of my family, my family, my family, my family, my family.
Your mom and dad.
Yes, exactly. And my brother, my sisters, their husbands. I'm so terrified of what they're going to think of me. Because, like I said, I knew it was wrong. There was no reasoning with me. From that instant, there's no reasoning.
Isn't that interesting how God works in each of us? This is the way he needed to talk to
you. Yeah, and I see other people gradually come out, but by... the grace of God opened my eyes, black and white, this is wrong. And from then on, there's no talking me back into that. I don't, even though I've lost all this stuff, oh, geez, it's worth Jesus.
Yeah.
The end product is worth it. A new family with true believers is worth it.
What did your mom and dad and family say when you eventually shared it with them?
I've never actually really talked about it with my dad. There was only just a brief conversation when I don't know, after he found out. I'd never told anybody because I was so scared. It was a year later, about the time of a family reunion, and they were going to go to the temple, and my sister had asked me if I was going, and I said I'm not going, and she put a lot of stuff together, put two and two together that I had left, and she asked me, and I said, yeah, I left the church, and then my mom came over that night, and just crying, and it was hard, because here's my mother, The woman that I love and I respect, and she was, you know how your father is supposed to be the disciplinary person that you're.
Yeah.
I was scared of my father, but I wanted to please my mother. I love my mother.
Yeah.
And so I broke her heart, and we had a conversation, and we didn't see eye to eye, and I knew that that's the way it was going to be. Because in Mormonism and Christianity, we use the same words, but they don't mean the same thing.
Isn't that true? Is she still active in the church?
Mm-hmm.
And has she been willing to listen at all? Any of your family been willing to listen?
My mother has listened to some things, but I get so flustered, and I'm so intimidated by my mother.
Yeah.
She's not I don't know why, but she intimidates me.
Well, sure.
And I get so wound up and so nervous that I can't do it.
Can't almost say the things that you pray for.
Oh, I pray for
pray
my
for
family.
Your mouth to open up and say the things that you know will touch her heart, maybe. But
I guess maybe I take the easier way out and I just pray that someone else is going to talk to her. I pray that
somewhere. Huh?
I pray that in God's sovereignty that He will put someone in their lives and that He will open their eyes. And I'm willing. I want to be there if she has questions, or any of my family or any of my friends.
Yeah,
if they have questions, I want to be there. I want to be there.
Well, it's such an interesting story, and so did you had this wonderful testimony of the church. Did you feel like you had a good testimony of Jesus growing up?
Yes, I had a testimony of Jesus, the LDS Jesus, obviously.
LDS Jesus.
I mean,
is it different now as a Christian?
Absolutely different. I mean, Jesus is a different person. Jesus is uncreated. In Mormonism, He was created, and in Mormonism, you know, He's your actual spirit brother, not just the brother in humankind, but He's your brother. He's kind of the same as you,
He just kind of happened to be first in line and raised His hand, and
you know, in fact, when it comes to that raising the hand thing, I always wondered why didn't I raise my hand? Was I not asked to? Because I thought I would love to raise my hand, you know.
Well, we've had a couple of people say they were mad at Jesus for stepping up in front of them. You know, it's why didn't I raise my hand? I never thought of that myself, but...
Jesus then and Jesus now is absolutely total. Different.
Well, I think you touched on it a moment ago when you said that we take our eyes off of Christ, whether it's to the temple, to the family, to the Book of Mormon, to Joseph Smith, whatever it is. Once you've taken your eyes off of Christ, you're worshiping another idol, another god.
Yeah, right? Mormonism sets up so many idols.
Yeah.
So many idols. People, your family, the temple is an idol. People don't realize what idols really are.
Yeah.
You know, and it's not just Jesus, but it's His work on the cross. They also take that away. It's that finished work on the cross that they take away.
Again, the blood, the shed blood.
It's that blood. It's that blood. On the cross, and
on
it was the death. It wasn't just because the blood was spilt, but it was actually the death with the blood.
Yeah.
Death had to happen, and the death is the payment for sin. And it happened, and He said, and tetelestai, it is finished. Payment in full, it's done.
It's done.
It's all the works are done.
And Mormons don't understand that.
They don't understand it.
And did all of this come to you just in that moment or two? I mean, you've had to study and learn, and but your concept of Mormonism was, at that moment, you just knew that it wasn't true.
Yes.
Yeah,
and it's a learning process. As Christians, you know, we're new creations, and we learn and
it can be tough, can't it? I mean, you do have to think a little.
Yeah, you do have to think a little, but you have the Bible right there.
As a foundation.
And the Bible cross-references itself numerously. I feel bad for people who don't understand how much is in the Bible. You can't exhaust the Bible of its knowledge.
Yeah.
Why would you have to add anything to that Bible?
Yeah.
It's bookended. Genesis, Revelation, it's all in there. Everything that you need to know. And they
Joseph
don't think
just
that it's,
added to it, didn't he?
He added to it, mostly by the Doctrine and Covenants. I mean, not really by the Book of Mormon.
No, because it doesn't
have nothing
that
in
much
the Book of Mormon.
Yeah. Well, we're actually running out of time, and I know you wanted to do something special tonight, and for the LDS people that might hear your story tonight, and anyone else. So, would you take over for a minute?
Yeah.
Say what you'd like to say. And
So what I want to do is I just want to pray. I want to pray for the viewers. I want to pray for you who are watching. Adelie prayed for me, and her family prayed for her, and God opened her eyes. So I'd just like to pray. Father God, I just want to come before you and praise you for you being so awesome and for you opening my eyes, my wife's eyes, and all the millions of people's eyes. God, I just want to pray for the viewers that you can enter into them and that you can use your word to cut through them with that two-edged sword. And I praise you because you are so awesome and your son sacrificed. And I hope that the viewers that are Christian, I know that they're praying with me, and I just pray for these viewers because you want them. You want them to be in your fold, and you want their burdens to be light, God. And I say this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Carl. Yeah. Well, I appreciate your story. It's really heartfelt, and you were so active and committed and family. You've given up a lot, haven't you?
I have, but it's all worth it.
You wouldn't change anything, would you?
No.
And I wouldn't either. I've learned so much. And do you feel like you know more about Mormonism now than you did before?
A lot more.
Yeah.
A lot more. See, that's the thing is my knowledge of Mormonism didn't bring me out of Mormonism. It was God that brought me out of Mormonism. And I know a lot more now.
Isn't that wonderful? Wow. And just convicted. I mean, you just knew. And going to church, has that been different for you? I mean, you're praising Christ and mm-hmm. God in church, are you? Is that different?
Absolutely. And I love it. I love singing the songs. I love worshiping. I love praising God. That's what it's about, is praising God for what he did.
Yeah.
And being with fellow believers.
And like you say, going back to meetings, like you've said, blessings and other things is just different, isn't it?
It's grievous, it's devastating, and it's
hard. We're actually almost out of time, but in a second or two, what do you think? I mean, obviously, we believe that the Mormons are deceived and blinded, and they see, but they don't see.
Exactly. They have eyes, but they don't see. They have ears, but they can't hear.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm saying. I need God. We need God, and he's sovereign, and he can make that happen. Open their eyes.
Carl, it's just a wonderful story, and I wish you well in all your adventures and all the dancing. You think you can keep doing this for years, dancing? You're in good shape.
Well,
I can tell
I look like I'm in good shape, but I'm not.
Well, some of us need to get in better shape, but we appreciate your story. Thanks so much. And you watching, I hope you'll pay attention and realize you're following the gospel of Joseph Smith and not the gospel of Jesus Christ. Good night.